Good evening, and welcome to Pérez Art Museum Miami. My name is Adrienne Chadwick, and I'm the Deputy Director for Education here at PAMM. Tonight, we're thrilled to be able to take a look at our exhibition, Steve McQueen, End Credits. And we have our Associate Curator, María Elena Ortiz, who's joining us with Susan Robeson and Alpesh Patel. So I'll be introducing them, and we'll be doing a conversation followed by a Q&A afterwards. Dr. Alpesh Patel is Associate Professor of Contemporary Art at Florida International University in Miami. His art historical scholarship, criticism, and curating reflects his queer, anti-racist, and transnational approach to contemporary art. He is the author of Productive Failure, Writing Queer Transnational South Asian Art Histories from Manchester University Press, and contributor to scholarly volumes such as Creolizing Europe, Legacies and Transformations, and peer-reviewed journals such as E. Mesferica, thank you. His research has been supported by grants and fellowships from the National Endowment of Humanities, at Arts Council of England, Fulbright Foundation, New York University, and Cranbrook Academy of Art. A frequent contributor to the international art magazines, he worked from 1998 to 2005 in the curatorial and director's departments of the Whitney Museum of American Art and New Museum of Contemporary Art in New York City. Dr. Patel received his PhD in art history and visual studies from the University of Manchester and a BA in history of art with distinction from Yale University. Susan Robeson is an award-winning documentary filmmaker, broadcast journalist, author, and longtime activist. She's produced extensively for public television stations and network affiliates in New York City. As an executive producer of the PBS public station in Minneapolis-St. Paul, Robeson ran a documentary unit and managed a second channel, which she transformed into a model for community empowerment and development. Robeson has worked extensively with street gangs around the nation, documenting efforts to organize peace treaties, and spent time in post-apartheid South Africa training township activists in broadcast quality video production. She also designed a nationwide citizen journalism initiative for the president of Timor-Leste, Nobel Peace Laureate Dr. Ramos Horta, to help foster civic engagement and build democracy in this first new nation of the 21st century. Early in her career, Robeson co-founded the Third World Newsreel, an independent film production and distribution collective for many years, produced Like It Is with Gil Noble on WABC TV. Robeson has been a visiting professor in film, American studies, and African American studies at McAllister College, Carleton College, and Colorado College, and is currently an adjunct professor in the communications department at William Patterson University. Robeson is the author of award-winning book, The Whole World in His Hands, a pictorial biography of Paul Robeson, and a forthcoming children's book, Grandpa Stops a War. She lives in the New York City area where she's producing her first dramatic feature film and is executive director of the Paul Robeson Foundation. Please join me in welcoming our speakers today, Susan and Alpha. Thank you.
Thank you, Adrienne. And you know, it's an honor and a pleasure to be here with both of you tonight. We're here. This program is related to a show that is actually now on view, which is called it's End Credits, a video by Steve McQueen, that focuses on an extensive documentation that the FBI had on an African-American performer, citizen of this country, named Paul Robeson. Some of us, you know, especially coming from a younger generation, perhaps we're not as in tune with this history of oppression and political persecution, but also the history of this great artist, intellectual, and as well athlete, because he was also a great athlete during his youth. Susan is his granddaughter, and I was wondering if you could tell us more, introduce the person to us.
Yeah, we're bringing him in the room first. Then we're going to talk about it.
Did my Lord deliver Daniel, deliver Daniel, deliver Daniel? Did my Lord deliver Daniel, and why not every man? He delivered Daniel from the lion's den, Jonah from the belly of a whale, and the Hebrew children from the fiery furnace, and why not every man? Did my Lord deliver Daniel, deliver Daniel, deliver Daniel? Did my Lord deliver Daniel, and why not every man? The moon runs down in a purple stream, the sun refused to shine. Every star did disappear, yes, freedom shall be mine. Did my Lord deliver Daniel, deliver Daniel, deliver Daniel? Did my Lord deliver Daniel, and why not every
How many people, I'm assuming that most of you know, sorry, I'm assuming that pretty much everybody is familiar with the basics. Who doesn't know, how many people really know a lot about Paul Robeson and what he stood for, what he did? Huh. Some of you, he's new to some of you? Ah, okay.
I'm telling you, the FBI did a good job.
Yeah, yeah. I grew up, just to place me, my father, Paul Robeson Jr., is his son, and an only child. And I was born in the era of the later stages of these documents, because they go back, there's different eras, the 30s, the 40s, the 50s. So I was born in the 50s era. So a lot of this is, a strange aspect of my own life and the impact that it had on me. But basically, I would say that my grandfather was somebody who, the quintessential Renaissance man who excelled. Beginning in the early 1900s, 1923, he graduated from college. So, as an athlete, the only black student on campus at Rutgers, the greatest end in the history of college football, he's considered. So he excelled first as an athlete, then in the early 20s as an actor and a singer, at a time when those professions didn't exist in the sense of a dignified level of art to them. And you could say he was probably America's first crossover artist, because he took the essence of black culture and dignified it and made it universal in America and concert stages around the world. And then as an activist, actually he had reached a kind of the pinnacle, really, of fame and fortune, which was extraordinary just in and of itself in terms of personal success. And he hit a moment, which is interesting, where he realized that personal success was just not enough. He actually went to and sang on the front lines of the Spanish Civil War, which was the beginnings of the rise of, historians call it Hitler's dress rehearsal for World War II. So he was really an anti-fascist and an anti-colonialist in London in the 30s. I'm not going to go on and on too much. His awareness expanded to like being global and connecting with freedom movements all over the world. And the turning point for him was when he went to Spain and sang on the front lines of the Civil War. And when he got, literally, he said, you know what? Put those speakers facing both sides of the front line. And so when he sang, and he sang through the night, the battle actually stopped. And it was that experience that gave him a sense of his responsibility as an artist to speak out, to use his powers to focus on issues of peace and freedom, really. And that you have to put your body on the line. You have to get out there, and you have to integrate that into who you are. And from there, he came back to this country and was at the forefront of the civil rights movement. There wasn't the formal civil rights movement. It was the generation of, like, don't rock the boat and go slow. And Mr. Robeson was the opposite. It was like, you know. So he was just the radical forefront of so much and paved the way for so much that came later. And I'll stop there.
But, you know.
So that gives you a sense.
But his ideas also cost him problems with politics and government. And you experienced that. Like, you lived the persecution and knowing that you're being constantly watched by FBI agents or other agents looking into what he was doing when, you know, especially, you know, after he got blacklisted and so on.
Well, yeah, my normal was different from most people's normal. So, for instance, we found out our post office in Harlem, one of the guys working there went to my father at one point and said, you know what, Mr. Robeson, when mail comes in to you or to your father, we do the following under instructions from the FBI. We take the mail down to the basement. We steam it open, we make a copy, we send the copy to Hoover, we close it back up, and then it goes back to you, you know. So we came across some of my, you know, dear grandpa and Nana letters from camp in these files. When my parents got married in 49, there was like a screaming mob shouting racist and fascist epithets outside this private wedding, and they could not leave Harlem without a bodyguard for many years. My grandfather had to move around with a bodyguard, which he often dispensed with. So I grew up, you know, there was a little code we had to call the house so that they knew, you know, that it was like the inner circle calling. It wasn't that deep of a cold. It was like you let the phone ring three times, hang up, let it ring twice, hang up, and then they would pick up on the next ring. That was the big secret code, you know. But as a kid, that made a big impression on me. So, you know, I just learned to, I understood security. I understood privacy, who to talk to, who not to talk to, and gave me an insight into a world that was a little more serious than the normal kid world, you know, as a 4-year-old and as a 5-year-old.
And now, you know, right now in our galleries, we have this video that very much presents a lot of those files that do present an image of your family. How was that experience of seeing all those files being presented, also the way they're presented, because for those of you who have seen the video, each page kind of scrolls down and there's blackouts on each of them, so you only also get a very limited view of what's in them, and you also get a very particular perspective of how people are being viewed in our community?
Well, I think that, you know, there are a couple of sides to it. One is I've seen, you know, there are thousands and thousands of, it's beautifully done. It's very powerful. There's something, one thing, it way it hits me is that I didn't necessarily have just looking through the documents, is that it's kind of Hoover, the FBI director, Hoover's twisted narrative of my grandfather's life. And a sense of the other thing, because there's so much misinformation in it that goes by. I mean, it's bizarre, actually, a lot of the information and the way it was obtained. But the other thing that hits me is how fearless my grandfather was. Nobody really knew the extent and the details of all this stuff they were, you know, gathering. But he, you know, there was always this refrain like, oh, it's too dangerous, Paul. And he would just kind of like shrug his shoulders, didn't say much, and would go right on and do it. And so I think about that when I see all this. I don't think he would really get that involved in it. It was like, okay, that was their... You know, on the other hand, it was disruptive, so it brings back a sense of how much the effects of that effect, you know, took over his life, of being banned really for, you know, practically a decade, not being able to perform, not being able to travel, and you see that go by. And I think the other thing that the other thing that I think about is that he was never bitter. You'd think that you'd have a sense, he never felt like a victim or saw himself as a victim, even though you could say he was victimized, but he didn't view his life because he made a choice. He knew what he was doing, he did it proudly, he did it with dignity. And he saw himself in many ways as, though he wouldn't say these things, as a kind of protector, you know, and a kind of lightning rod. I'll take the hit, you know, I'll be the battering ram for my people or for the movement. And so I've all those things sort of come forth in a strange kind of way. On another level, and you probably have a lot of, it's interesting. I'm sure everyone has a different experience of it, but it's a little distancing for me because it's kind of unreal. It's like fake news. There's a lot of fake news in there, and just the abuse of the state's abuse of power. So it's kind of distancing in that way, as well as oppressive. So there's like a lot of layers and levels. You probably have a different sensibility.
It's funny that you said fake news because there's this interesting slippage in that word between the past and the present. Fake news being something that, you know, we use more now. But I think I was going to talk about my own experience seeing it, which is very different for sure. I mean, the work in some ways is kind of... a strange kind of portraiture. It has all this information, some of which is, you know, redacted or blacked out. It's how many hours does this work?
The video is about 8 hours, and just to also give you more context, you know, Steve McQueen, he's a great filmmaker. He did 12 Years a Slave, which won an Academy Award. He's a prolific artist, but he also makes video work. And this video is actually quite experimental. And by that I mean that it's not a single shot of video. It's rather a lot of files that he got together in that end credit kind of movement to look like a video. But it was never like shot. The video, it's around 8 or 9 hours. And then there's an audio file. So there's two different files that make up the installation. The audio file is about 19 hours.
19 hours. it's an amount that you can't even kind of fathom to sit and listen to that, you could say. And so when I went into the installation, I want to talk about my experience and tie it to a couple of things. One is to really maybe explore this division or between art and activism, or what is art that has an activist edge? What does that do that's different than pure activism that has a very kind of singular goal, for instance? So that's something I want to think through by telling you my experience. Also just thinking about artworks as not things, but verbs, right? They do something. They create relations in some way. So for me, when I went into the work and sat there for a while, I was very frustrated. And there was this kind of level of monotony and even boringness, you could say, that exists with the work. Frustration because, you can't actually... it goes by very quickly, so you can't necessarily read everything that's there. What's there is already kind of partial. So, there's this inability to kind of get information, despite the fact there's all this information that is there, which is very paradoxical. So I had this moment in the exhibition where, at some point the work became less about what was sort of on the screen and more about how I was engaging with it. And it eventually got to the point where I was sort of more interested in what was happening around me. When I go into an installation, that's generally not the case. I don't really think about who else is around me, if there are people there, more or less. But in this context with the work, the way it kind of exists, there's only so much you can take of it, in a sense, and you begin to kind of go into your own headspace. So when I was there, there were a group of who I assumed to be school students that came in. They had backpacks, and my first thought was just, I had like this moment of anxiety because I was thinking, how much do they know about the work before they're coming in? That is, if you go into the work without having read some information, it could be very confusing. And there is a lot of racially charged language that we don't really use a lot anymore, let's say, colloquially even, like even Negro. And I began to be kind of worried about how these children would be receiving this kind of information, and if they had enough sort of a enough of a background to kind of engage with the work in some way. They were also children that, at least as far as I could tell, were of color, and this was sort of, this other kind of pull for me. It, given again the context, what were they thinking? So, I was having these kind of moments of anxiety almost, and just thinking about these kids and what they might actually be experiencing themselves, instead of worrying about what I'm experiencing, what they're experiencing. And it was this wonderful moment for me through that, where it seemed like that's where the power of this work was for me, that it created this opportunity to kind of have relations, you could say, that I might otherwise not have. And to give context to that, recently with all the shootings that have happened in high schools and the one that's happened very close to us in South Florida, when that all happened, I really kind of shut down. I did not want to hear about it. I didn't want to read about it. I needed to not kind of have any information about that in my space. It was a bit too much. And what I realized through this work of being in this McQueen work was that maybe I don't have that option. That if I want to be part of this world, right, be related and be connected, then I have to engage. What that engagement is kind of up for negotiation, you could say, but that it's important that I do engage in some way. So there was this, very interesting, powerful moment where the work's almost disinterested quality led to something which was unexpected for me. And because I'm an art historian, I brought some slides, of course, for you to see. I wanted to, just to give you more context, I wanted to bring up this work by Andy Warhol. So in the 60s, he did this wonderful work called Empire, and it's 8 hours and 5 minutes of one shot of the Empire State Building. So again, you have this notion of durationality and time and of a kind of aesthetics of boredom that's there. You know, some people have attributed this to a cynicism in Warhol's work. And I think that's partially there. But there's also something else that's interesting there. When you have a work like this, the experience of engaging with it becomes more about you and your connection or your relation to the Empire State Building. That is to say that it's no longer about this object or thing, but about the viewer. You know, who are you? What is your relationship to what you're looking at? I mean, here, there's not really the kind of political spectrum that I'm saying McQueen's work does, but there is this sense of, you know, shifting the work back to the viewer in a way. What is your relationship to what's being shown? What is your relationship to similar matters that are happening right now around us? And you know, all of these things are kind of happening to me at the same time, which is really kind of a really fascinating and kind of scary at the same time too, I think, in some sense.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely think that now all of us, more than ever, are being confronted with situations in which we're being asked to take a stand. And where, and by I mean by that, it's, you know, kids in a high school being shot at, you know, from a very young age, they're learning that there's more at stake here than consumption of objects and so on. And definitely, you know, when we think about Robeson and the way he was treated, it's really not that similar to, you know, there was an article that came out 2 days ago about Colin Kaepernick mentioning that the Baltimore Ravens were interviewed by the U.S. military last year when they were considering signing him, and ultimately he was still not, he was not signed, but that shows that there's still episodes in which citizens of this country are either being asked to engage in a very direct way or also being reprimanded or being watched and yeah, oppressed for engaging, which I think that certainly, and you working in an educational setting, you know, I hear that, I'm sure that FIU has got, they might, you guys might even have to carry guns now too. So there's, you know, there's this other layer of.
Oh, hopefully not. But right, there is, I didn't even think about that aspect, and I don't want to have to think about that. But again, I'm going to potentially have to. And, you know, I mean, I should say, like, it's a good conversation to have about what it means to be activists. Again, like, we have students in South Florida, right, in these high schools that are doing incredible work trying to make change in the law. That is a kind of activism. You know, I'd say it's just as important or powerful as what this Steve McQueen work does and how it affected me, right? Like, it changed me, one person, and my relation to the people around me. And that can have a kind of incremental, powerful effect that can't be codified or quantified in the way we like to kind of sometimes do with effects. I mean, this can be the slipperiness of art. Like,
but, you know, you mentioned Andy Warhol, but what about works that perhaps relate to Steve McQueen's gesture in a more direct way?
So the next slide that I have is a really fantastic work by Adrian Piper. It's meant to exist digitally. That is to say, it's sort of meant to be tweeted and emailed. You can download it yourself for free. It's not an object to be kind of consumed or even have a price tag on. And it came out of her sort of frustration with the sort of continuing violence again against male men of color, black men in the United States, around the time when Trayvon Martin actually was shot and killed. So this work is a very interesting, again, you know, strategy that is connected to Warhol and even McQueen, where you're looking at a portrait or a very kind of ghostly portrait of Trayvon Martin. That portrait was circulated so much around the time that he passed away. I mean, to the point where there was almost no agency for this young kid, right? That it was completely removed, you could say. So here you just have like this kind of you know, specter of him, and you can think of this two ways. It could be that it's this idea that we so quickly forget. You know, mass shootings, for instance, things happen, we forget them, so easily. And there's also another side to kind of say that we forget them, and yet they're kind of specters that remain and don't stubbornly disappear, right? They're always there nonetheless. So there's this funny tension, but again, in terms of like viewership, when you're looking at this, there's nothing to really look at. You know, there's not much there for you. There's nothing there in terms of even Trayvon Martin. So what happens again is that your connection to this, you know, portrait is about your about you and your relationship to Trayvon Martin and what's happening in some way. So when you know, she writes on the bottom, imagine what it was like to be me. The idea is, right, that we're shifting the work to be about you. And can you imagine what it was like, right, to be Trayvon Martin? And in that moment, Trayvon Martin doesn't become an object anymore in some way. He begins to have some agency, which is something that I really kind of interested in, this idea that maybe that there's a recovery of some of his agency. And it's funny, I kind of feel like with the McQueen work that there's an interesting kind of recovery or agency of Paul Robeson. That is to say, there's, you know, all this information, and supposedly that's supposed to tell you something. The irony is the joke's on the FBI. That doesn't tell you anything about Paul Robeson at all. In the end, it kind of returns the kind of agency to these individuals that have become kind of stock figures or icons that are, you know, kind of manipulated and used kind of over and over again in various ways.
Yeah, I think the issues, well, one thing that comes out so much is the issues are so much has, there's been so much progress, but so little has changed. And, you know, when you think about violence against black men, racist violence, particularly against black men, I mean, that was so prominent in my grandfather's time. And he was so outspoken about it when other people were afraid to speak out. I mean, he challenged President Truman and, you know, said how hypocritical that your lead, the U.S. is leading the prosecution of Nazi criminals in at the Nuremberg trials, and yet there's a lynching like right next to your hometown, and you can't even, you know, you have nothing to say about it, and an anti-lynching bill has been, you know, stuck in Congress for decades. And, you know, Truman's reaction was that foreign policy is basically none of your business, and as an American, you have to support foreign policy. You know, it's got nothing to do with, you know, how black people are treated or civil rights. And so that, you know, I think those, you know, so that those issues of, and he was always saying, I want protection for my people in Mississippi. You know, why aren't you going down and doing something about it? And those were big issues that a lot of people were afraid to confront the government about. The other piece, I think, is this overall overriding thing about when you bring up Colin Kaepernick, who I have enormous respect for. I think he has done so much and woke so many people up with such dignity and such integrity, and he's paid a price. He didn't know that was going to happen, but he didn't back down. Is this right to freedom of political expression? And how that's still challenged today, and that was what my grandfather was singled out for, and he refused to back down. And I think for those of you who don't know that much about him, that kind of attitude is what made him so much of a hero to millions of people all over the world, that he refused to be intimidated into silence and kept talking about the civil rights movement in the U.S. is connected to the freedom movements of people all over the world, and that we're not a minority, we're a majority. And this idea of a global awareness and a global consciousness. And so that, you know, I just, you know, these issues are just so prevalent. You know, Colin Kaepernick doesn't have a right to express his political views because he's a football player or something. I mean, it's a, you know, that kind of, or that Robeson didn't because he's an artist. So the idea of really you know, fighting for that and standing up for that and not backing down is just so, you know, relevant today. I found this little quote, and I saw passport stuff go by in the section I saw, but this just gives you some idea of what the government's thoughts were. So this is what the secretary, this is what the FBI told him when they came to say, give us your passport back. And he wanted to know, you know, it's revoked, it's canceled in 1950, and he wanted to know why. So this is what he was told. This was the State Department's official position. Secretary of State Dean Acheson considers Mr. Robeson's travel abroad detrimental to the best interests of the United States. His frequent criticism of the treatment of Negroes in America should not be aired in foreign countries. If Mr. Robeson wants the Secretary of State or the State Department to reconsider, he must sign a statement guaranteeing he will make no speeches while he's abroad. And that was really the issue. And of course he refused. So it's you know, it's so similar and hard to believe in a way.
I mean, the other ironic part about what you just said in terms of how much things haven't changed or have changed is this role of the FBI. And by that I mean that, you know, in this work, the FBI, you know, it's the villain. You know, they're the ones that are oppressing and they're the ones that are gathering, you know, under the Hoover administration, all this information. But in our world, the FBI has become some type of good guy? I mean, is that even correct? Like,
well, I don't know if they become good guys, but they...
standing up to the bad guys, though.
Yeah, which is something kind of bizarre also in terms of the moment that we're living today.
But the other thing is that, you know, it's not... Well, the FBI of Hoover represents, of J. Edgar Hoover, the total abuse of power and authoritarianism, and actually being somewhat of a terrorist in terms of how he used information and even terrorized various presidents to keep them in line and keep his thumb on top of everything with his so-called information and his files. So it represents that era, which went from the mid-20s till, I don't know, 60s, 70s, or somewhere in there, decades. So that's that era. But it's also, if you look at those documents, it's he's sending information to intelligence related to secretary, the State Department intelligence is in on this. There's back and forth. The CIA and the whole national security apparatus, as it was then, because Hoover had decided for some reason back in the early 40s that Paul Robeson was a threat to national security. And that was the evolution of his long obsession that reflects. And even had him put on what he called his custodial detention list in the 1940s. So my grandfather's starring on Broadway in Othello, which was historic in and of itself, and he is literally just been put on 24-hour surveillance, like with people following him physically.
I wanted to ask you, Susan, because you mentioned Othello, and that we know that Robeson was an activist in a global sense, as you described, but he was an artist as well, an actor, and I'm really curious about what your thoughts are about how his artistic sort of presence, in a way, was itself activism, what the art that he made.
Well, he did keep a sort of separation, in a way, I mean, with his professional career and then his career, or what he did as an activist. But it sort of all, it all merged because of the way, just of his presence. So the music spoke that, you know, that was music of resistance, which people appreciated as great classical music, On the other hand, they were the songs that his father, who had been born a slave and escaped when he was 15 years old to freedom, sang, you know, and that people sang it, and used codes in them to organize resistance. So there was always this double edge to it.
Amazing, just that, you know, that the voice, that was something that couldn't be taken away right. in some way from slaves, right? And that idea of, you know, again, sound and art, that kind of created, you know, a kind of activism, mobilizing people in some way.
Right. And I think also just there was just the personal side, just his persona and his charisma and magnetism, which was just something extraordinary, this, you know, man who towered over everybody, whose voice, you know, boomed out, like shook the walls when he, you know, he spoke in your house in a room, and how intimate he was with people, and how he connected. So he had a way of empowering you by, you know, you would be the most important person to him when he was talking to you, and you would feel that. And he had a way of waking up, you know, your own sense of who you are and empowering you to be somebody and do something. And so there was this incredible spirit of generosity that he conveyed, and intimacy and friendship that somehow came through in everything that he did. And I think that was a piece, plus his, yeah. I mean, it was just kind of like a kaleidoscope where everything clicked and just became more and more beautiful and powerful, whatever he did.
It's just interesting that, you know, as this almost complete Renaissance man, as you said, right, that that is not something that higher education necessarily is interested in. It's about instrumentalization and utility, and how much can we measure when someone graduates, et cetera. That the idea of creating a cosmopolitan man or woman is something that seems sort of less relevant on just an institutional level. From my own experience, you know, working in a state university where there's all kind of metrics that can prevent the humanities with human in it, from really flourishing in some way, which is really unfortunate. But it, you know, just hearing you talk about him and as a Renaissance man, you know, that where can education, you know, kind of help produce something similar in some way? It seems like the way in which I'm seeing it emerge may not be necessarily the way forward in that sense.
Or at least support. I mean, I agree. I think that he really much embodies the human potential in terms of what we are as beings. You know, we are creative. We also have, you know, smartness. And we're also incredibly physical. And you don't see that often anymore at all. Like, even with the people that we praise or are celebrities, they're not really honoring our potential as a species.
Yeah, I mean, for example, just, you know, singing and speaking in would be an example in 12, 13, 14 languages, you know, so that was an artistic choice, but it was also a very political choice that galvanized people, and also the type of music that he sang was the heart songs and the folk music of the world. In a way, as opposed to opera. Some people describe him as an opera singer, always looking for the roots in, you know, everyday culture, really, over time. So, and his the international flavor, really, of his repertoire as an artist. And songs of resistance that he sang, like he would sing the song that, you know, came out of the resistance to fascism in Europe, and became part of his repertoire. So it was all integrated in that way. Or when he did Othello, Shakespeare's Othello, he gave it a sort of modern, an interpretation of this was a black man of African roots whose culture was being undermined and attacked, and he didn't kill out of jealousy necessarily, but there were other levels operating in terms of how the state, the Venetian state, was sort of working against him and undermining him as an outsider and as a Moor, as a black Moor. So there were, and that was art, you know, but when he did Othello on Broadway, I mean, people poured out of Harlem and Hell's Kitchen and the South Bronx and everywhere because there was, like, reality on the stage, even though it was Shakespeare and Othello, and the tour, the national tour of it, just, you know, people thought he couldn't do it because there would be riots, you know, to have a black man kill a white woman on the strangler on the stage, you know, but he turned it into a form of looking at segregation and racism in the society in a different way. So even, you know, high art was political.
And that's
and that was one of his
was
crowning
touring,
achievements, really.
But this toured around the nation.
Yes,
this,
it did.
That's really fantastic. I mean, in the sense that, like, you know, that it was not just a New York-based thing, but you can imagine the kind of ripple effects that could have.
And right? You know, for the most part, he was pretty, he stuck to his principles. But for instance, for that tour, he subjected himself to Jim Crow because he felt it was more important to bring this to audiences and fight this stereotype and resistance to seeing this in, you know, on the stage in a mainstream way. So he kind of dealt with what he refused to deal with his entire career, which he was one of the first people to have contracts that said, I will not perform under segregated conditions. And in 1942 in Kansas City, which was, he was like the top, he was with Frank Sinatra, like number one concert artist. And he came out on stage and he looked around and he could see the audience was segregated against violating his contract. And in the intermission, the Go Slow Negroes said, he was ready to walk out. And they said, no, Paul, you know, you gotta go back. You know, I hate to name names, but that was Leroy Wilkins, his early days. No, you gotta do it, you know, da da da. And he went back out and he sang Jim Crow song, a song, you know, a radical kind of anti-racist song called Jim Crow, and the audience, people in the audience got the message and stood up and integrated the theater right then and there. And then his next stop on his tour in Santa Fe, the hotel canceled his reservation. And they said, because it's the proximity to the South in New Mexico, and we can't have a black man in this hotel. And so he canceled his contract. And it was like headline news, stuff like that. So even you're trying to be an artist. But when he toured Othello, you know, he did it.
So we're running out of time, so I want to open it up for questions or comments before the night ends.
In terms of time. Oh, we'll go a little late.
So Anita, and she will be walking around with microphones. If you have any comments or if you want to join in, please make a gesture and they'll get to you.
Hello. You had said that he was kind of pre the form of what we know of as the civil rights era, probably from the 50s to the 70s, mid-50s to the 70s. Well, he didn't die until in 70s, right?
1976, yes.
Right, so what relationships did he form with those early leaders of the civil rights movement, like Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, and maybe some others that came before for them that maybe I can't even think of their names.
Right. Well, what you, some of, huh? Yes, the early, the NAACP that kicked out W.E.B. Du Bois because he was a communist. That NAACP was that time. The 50s, his 1950, his passport was revoked. At the same time, a virtual ban took place where there was no concert hall anywhere in America that would rent to him to sing for any amount of money, no recording studio. And this was orchestrated really by various government agencies, literally going around and intimidating people. Records disappeared from stores. If you were seen with Paul Robeson and you lost your job, if you were a radio DJ and you played his song, you were out. So there was a kind of curtain, you know, there was a kind of, he was like a banned person in South Africa. And he was, this whole thing is about labeling. So he was labeled a communist. Now, this was right, so in 1955, when the Montgomery bus boycotts happened, that was right in the middle of that. So he was kind of, if he reached out to King, he was isolated. That was one of the things that they succeeded in doing. He would taint, so to speak, because of how he had been labeled and portrayed and banned and all that, the movement. So he didn't. Because it was problematic. I mean, King had to like renounce a lot of his advisors who were progressives because of all this. So he watched, he gave support as he could, as he was able to make statements and do things, he did. When SNCC came along, John Lewis in his early days, they said boldly, "We are Paul's children." So that generation is the one in the early 60s that embraced him, even when it was still dangerous to do that. So it was a very fraught sort of political landscape dealing with Paul Robeson, actually. And there were some brave people like Lena Horne, who went out of her way and was a close friend, like Dizzy Gillespie, like Harry Belafonte, but there were Sidney Poitier. There were many who ran the other direction because you lost your career and you jeopardized your life. And then by the time he got his passport back, that was 1958, and he went to Europe, to England, to reestablish his career for a couple of years. And by 1963, he was ready to retire. Then 65 was like 85 today, considering what he had withstood. So in some ways, time kind of intervened. Malcolm X reached out to him. He went to, when Lorraine Hansberry died, and you all should see the new documentary on Lorraine Hansberry if you have not seen it. She died in 60, right before Malcolm was assassinated. We all went to her funeral. Malcolm approached my grandfather, in essence, and said, "I would like to sit down and meet with you." My father was in the process of orchestrating or setting up that meeting when Malcolm was gunned down at the Audubon Ballroom. So Malcolm was very aware of his global focus. He was very aware of his passport case and all the issues behind that. And you could say that there was tremendous connection between where Malcolm went in terms of his international perspective. And he was trying to make that link with where Paul left off, but he was assassinated. I don't know if that answers your question. I can't see for the lights where it came from. Oh, it was over there, yeah.
Any other questions, comments?
I have the tendency to think that things have changed because here I am today, and I'm a woman, and I can vote. So, but my concern is probably with respect to these new generations, because I very highly appreciate the right of freedom of speech. And this social media craziness where you can block people just because you disagree, it's something I don't like. So how do you approach these new generations? Or is there a recommendation or something to try to teach them the value of freedom of speech, even when you disagree?
Well, you know, I'll just, you know, say something. I think that, you know, social media, you know, they make money out of your opinion. So it's actually designed in a way that it's supposed to reinforce what you like and the way you think. So even though it's a public setting, I wouldn't think that that's reality. That's just a marketing tool that is used to make money for other people. So, and I think we should take it for what that is, and we should take time off social media. I strongly recommend that, because there's a world out there to live. I was a little bit pessimistic, like yourself, in terms of new generations, but I have to say that I feel like the people that are most close to a problem often have the best solutions. Like, think about what's happening in Parkland. You know, they were in a problem and they're trying to find a solution for it. The undocumented students is another great example of people that are, you know, in a problem and are trying to lobby and to find solutions for their cause. So I think that
just with Parkland, you know, social media is a big part of how that's even happening. So, you know, kind of a mobilization of it in a very kind of productive way. I mean, just as an instructor of, I guess, what we might say, this new generation, which, you know, I mean, it's hard to generalize as well. But in my experience with the students that I have, you know, kind of like, you know, you said that you're optimistic. I see there's a lot of reason to be optimistic. So there's a potential. It's so easy to kind of brand and generalize, I think, and maybe that's where there can be a huge problem sometimes.
And I feel like often we should just also, you know, what can I do? I mean, my position here, you know, I work in a museum. Programs like this are ways in which I feel like that's something that creating spaces for conversation. So I also think that the beauty of the moment that we're living today is that we actually can engage in a more public way. So I would also encourage that.
And I also want to just kind of want to, I guess, put in the context of art, that museum space, you know, spaces that allow for a different kind of experience than something that happens online becomes more and more important. I feel that museums are going to have increasingly more of a central focus for us.
Yeah, and we have the power. Like, if we would all close our Facebook accounts, it wouldn't be a thing anymore, you know? So, Any other?
I just want to make a comment based on the observation of the actual conversation between Ms. Robeson and Dr. Patel, which I think is, it hits to, I believe, my wanting to see more of McQueen's work. And that's the direct relationship of the photographs, for example, of Andy Warhol and the other one that you showed, and how a viewer can be almost transposed to like some other place. I found that really interesting. I also believe that that the conversation that just took place could be like a really wonderful kind of lead into the work of McQueen, if that's what you're trying to, if that's what you were trying to establish, Ms. Robeson.
I mean, it's actually a good question. I don't know how many of you have experienced the work, you know, I guess it's sort of like I'm presenting one sort of experience and way of looking at things, and I'm sure everyone in the room is going to have a slightly different experience as well. I have the privilege here of being able to share my experience, which thank you, Maria Elena, to bringing me here to be able to do that. But I would definitely encourage everyone to kind of think of how I've framed this as just that. It's one frame, one way of looking at the work. One of my students today mentioned that the image of the work that's used on some of the PAMM sort of signage, it's from another installation, not here. And that one looks different. The experience of being in that installation is probably going to be hugely different than the one here. So even this, you know, kind of change in space could alter the work itself in a really fascinating and interesting way.
I just wanted to thank Susan Robeson for keeping her grandfather in the light, if you will. Keeping his memory alive and what he stood for, it's so important today. And I am very optimistic about the future. And I just wanted to share a short story of a man I learned about in New York City, who was the first African-American doctor named James McCune Smith. And he had to go to Glasgow, Scotland to get his medical degree. And I believe he had a lot of European background. He was also an abolitionist, by the way, and he was active around in the 1860s, around the time of the Civil War, just afterwards. But he was a freed slave, and he went on to get his medical degree. And he had a lot of European blood, and I guess he married also a woman who was lighter skinned, and their children were very light skinned, and unfortunately, he went on to die in a pauper's grave, and for many centuries, his family did not know about him or that they were related to him until his great-great-great-granddaughter found his name in a family Bible and made the connections and connected the dots and found who he was and how important he was in his, you know, in his time. So I'm hopeful about the future because only 100 years ago before your grandfather was, you know, being so proactive in everything. We had, unfortunately, the first black physician in this country whose children and grandchildren and so forth passed for white because they had more opportunities, and it was very unfortunate. So hopefully in 100 years from now, you know, we'll have a lot more progress.
Let's make it 10, like 100 years, you know.
I just want to reflect upon something you said. You said that we've made progress, but little has changed. And I read about your grandfather years ago, and probably around the time he died. And it's my belief, and I could be wrong about this, that he was probably affected by the House on Un-American Activities and Joe McCarthy. And it seems kind of ironic to me, and it shows you the far reach of this, you know, this racist regime that, you know, that's pretty much been in power for since the beginning of this country, that it's still going on when you have the man that sits in the White House right now being he considered Roy Cohn his mentor, and that goes right back to the days of your grandfather, and I'm sure he was directly affected by that man and all the, you know, all the havoc that he wrecked in the lives of many, many people, not just your grandfather. So I just think there's a terrible irony there. And as much as we have progressed, we haven't changed.
Right, that line through of that history. Roy Cohn was Joseph McCarthy's lawyer and his sort of right-hand person. And Roy Cohn helped orchestrate a lot of the strategies around McCarthyism and what Joseph McCarthy was doing, and he became Trump's father's lawyer. And Trump grew up, Donald Trump grew up, you know, with Roy Cohn as a mentor. So you sort of see the, you know, the how the beat goes on in that side, and just the bizarre use of language where Trump is claiming that, you know, witch hunts are being, you know, carried out against him, which is something Nixon said, you know, sort of turning that upside down. And I think also just the, I mean, we haven't said the word fascism, but one of the things my grandfather was, I mean, they called him a premature anti-fascist. I mean, he saw the wave before the wave hit, and he experienced it personally with, you know, stormtroopers in Berlin on a, in, you know, in the early 1930s. And he was very, and going to Spain and all of that, that they say fascism creeps in on cat's paws. And if we don't pay attention, that kind of authoritarianism that is, you know, and the kind of alt-right and what could happen so easily in Charlottesville and, you know, what happened in Peekskill and, you know, we're getting tested. You know, and in Germany, before Hitler came to power, it was a democracy. He was part of the parliament, as was his party. You know, so nothing happens exactly the same way, but I think taking from your point, we should pay attention to what is fascism and how does it creep in on cat's paws and how do people sleep through that process to make sure that we don't, because we may look up and things are getting a little tight in that department. It's not so, yeah. I think it's important to say that word and think about that word, fascism, and understand its history and the way it plays out coming forth from democracies and how leaders prey on people's fears to get in that kind of control.
So I wasn't going to ask the question, but I'm going to now. So in our time now, coming from a history of all of, I came from a small place, I learned about Paul Robeson. Who is our Paul Robeson now? Or who would you look to now, continuing the footprints of this work? Because it can't be in a vacuum. Are they writers? Are they artists? Who's doing the work now?
Well, what do people hear? What do you think? What do you think? Huh?
I was going to say you have to look to yourself and the people around you. I mean, we can collectively be that Paul Robeson. It doesn't need to be some individual that is, you know, sort of far away and inaccessible.
Well, I would just
That's a nice side answer.
I would say that, and he's the older generation, but Harry Belafonte has done so much to put my grandfather's name in the forefront, in front of a younger generation. If you go online and look at sankofa.org, he has, everyone's heard of John Legend, right?
Yes.
Usher. Mm-hmm. Alicia Keys.
Yes.
Yeah. Harry has schooled and connected the dots for a lot of people like that to say, if I've picked up the Hollywood Reporter, and every time John Legend says something, he says, I'm following in Paul Robeson's footsteps. You know, so there are a lot of people out there in popular culture who get it and who are trying. Common and Jesse Williams and a lot of major people who are, Macklemore, you know, you'd be surprised who understand. And there are a wave of writers and black intellect, you know, it's there, but we have to, I want to read you, there were two quotes I thought of to bring today. And I think we have to pay attention and empower and support the Colin Kaepernicks, you know, and the writers, you know, and the artists, and encourage them and let them know, like, we want that, you know, you're not going to lose us. So it's kind of on us in a way, but this is something James Baldwin wrote about my grandfather, and I just think it speaks to that. Robeson lives overwhelmingly in the hearts and minds of the people whom he touched, the people for whom he was an example, the people who gained from him the power to perceive and the courage to resist. It is not a matter of historical interpretation. It is a matter of bearing witness to that force which moved among us. We must do this so that our children's children's children will know better than we did how to honor and protect him when they meet him in their own lives. And so it's on. And then there's one other thing, because there's so many people. Toni Morrison said, the function of freedom is to free another. And so I think we just all have to, like, bring these things to the fore in our own lives, what we do with our children and our grandchildren and in our families. Because I'm the way I am because it was in my family. And I got it there first. And so, yeah, I mean, that's a long answer. But, okay. So you got a job, because you know. Are you from Jamaica? Right. Were you there in Kingston? Right. And I think we need to, like, young people are the ones who change the world. We forget that. We really forget that. All across time and, you know, the globe, it's young people. And I think it, you know, we have to pay attention to that and support that and make them know that we're there, we got their back. You know, that's what Harry has done, you know, because he had the platform and he had the experience and to bring to bear. But yes, it's that's where the power is, and that's where change is going to come from. I mean,
an example, we have it here in South Florida with these students that are using social media actually, right, to change the world. They are doing it, right? And they are young, they're still in high school. So, you know, again, like, just even that question, I just want to kind of address it again about, you know, where is Paul Robeson? Like, I mean, we need to look to ourselves for that. You know, and I think that is where we can potentially, like, really make a lot of change. And we're moving back to the artwork again. I think this is what the artwork does. It kind of, you know, connects you back into the world in a sense. It doesn't tell you how to be in the world, but it does connect you back into it. And it's so easy to close ourselves off.
Yeah, one last question.
Lucky me. Yeah, just to pick up on that that notion that Paul Robeson lives in all of us, we unfortunately got here late. You might have mentioned what I think is his most famous quote, his epitaph, in fact, at Fernwood Cemetery: "The artist must elect to fight for freedom or for slavery. I've made my choice. I had no alternative." And I think a lot of us essentially live by that and take that to heart. My question is about a specific incident here in Florida, that from what I've read was very significant because of Paul Robeson speaking out on it. And this was the Christmas night 1951 bombing of the home of Harry T. Moore and Harriet V. Moore up in sort of north central Florida. They were very active in the NAACP and the voter registration movement, and their home was bombed. They were killed. And it seemed, from what I was reading, that Paul Robeson, and this is like just a year after his passport was revoked, the fact that he spoke out very boldly and publicly about that seemed to have really energized what there was not really a civil rights movement to speak of, but, you know, that movement that kind of led up to Brown v. Board, the Supreme Court decision. That it seems that his speaking out on that was a very catalytic moment, and that it might also have been for him personally. And I just wonder if you could comment on that.
Well, I think you've really said it, and thank you so much for bringing that up. I kind of forgot that was, yeah, Florida, Central Florida. But yes, that was something that he, in many ways, you know, Chuck D said, you know, hip-hop is Black America's CNN. And I think in those times, in the 40s and even in the 50s, when they, you know, there was about silencing him, that he was able to do that because he put forth information and crystallized ideas and situations that people needed to pay attention to, where you wouldn't get it anywhere else. And that was a very good example that people paid attention. And it empowered people. It gave people the courage to keep on and not feel forgotten and to step out, even probably locally. You, I'm sure, know more about it than I do, of the impact of that. And just to kind of put a little capper on that, when my grandfather would speak at a rally, he routinely packed like Madison Square Garden with 10, I think it's max was 10,000 people and standing room only, you know, which, so his public meetings were huge events, and he was putting forth ideas and information that you couldn't get anywhere else about what was going on in the world and what issues to pay attention to and what people were doing. And you couldn't get that anywhere else. And he became kind of that CNN, not just for Black America, but for progressive people, all, you know, across the board. So these were integrated audiences. That's, you know, in those, in, you know, Grant Park, you know, he gave a concert and spoke to 100,000 people and integrated. I mean, he drew crowds like this wherever he went. So there was that kind of knowing that by bringing something up, you empowered as well as, you know, protected people as much as he could, you know. Thank you for that. Would have been really remiss not.
Well, thank you, Susan.
Hmm? Thank you. Right. I always thought of it as Jacksonville, but Mims.
Well, thank you, Susan. Thank you, Alpesh, and thank you all for sharing with us. Before we go, though, we have one more.
Goodbye.
When Israel was in Egypt's land, let my people go. Oppressed so hard they could not stand, let my people go. Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt's land. Tell all Pharaoh to let my people go. Spake the Lord upon Moses, said, let my people go. If not, I'll smite your firstborn dead. Let my people go.